back. I'm really looking forward to the presentation. Thank you very
Thanks
much.
A lot. Okay, so today I basically split the presentation in two parts. The first part is a little bit more historical. Okay, I present what happened at the beginning of Pulp, how the project started and its evolution. The second part will be more a little bit more technical, and I will describe basically the different architectures available, chips implemented, and the main achievements of the project. So let's start from the beginning. The project started 10 years ago, and it's a collaboration between the University of Bologna and ETH Zurich. And the reason for that is that, let's say, the inspirator of the project is Luca Benini, who is a professor both in ETH Zurich and the University of Bologna. So the reason for this project basically was behind the need of researcher to do research, let's say, on a computer architecture without having any connections or string or constraints from proprietary IP. So at that time, basically, there were very few open source IPs, and if you wanted to work with any of the IP, you had to engage with a company, and it was very difficult to get access to processors, IPs, and so on. So we started this project with the research goal of basically create new architectures, multi-core architectures for IoT kind of applications, and we wanted to be open source. So the original approach we wanted to exploit was exploit open source IPs as much as possible. And let's say two famous sentences that were said at the time: we'll never do a processor, because basically we wanted to create architectures but not the processor itself, and not the compiler itself, because at the beginning we were a very small team. Actually, I was alone in the first year, the first months. So I started looking at, let's say, some reasonably good IPs, both open source and non-open source, and especially processors. And looking at, let's say, the landscape of available processors in the IoT domain, so I was looking on small processors in the order of few tens of kilogate. Basically, in the end, the choice went to OHR 1-2000, and this basically established the link between the Pulp project and the OrConf. So this was basically a reasonably good quality IP, around 50 kilogate, which was the target. It was open source, and it was a good open source because it was an easily readable code. There were other processors there in the list, but let's say they were quite hard to read and modify. There was compiler support for it, and there was a community support. So in 2013, I decided to go to OrConf. I think it was the second OrConf, and I think you can recognize some faces here, apart from me. And in order to meet, let's say, the community supporting the processor and the OpenRISC ISA. And while I was there, I presented, let's say, our first tasks in the project, which was basically related to kind of improve the performance of the original open source processor, because the processor was good, but since we wanted to do research on energy efficient and high performance architecture, we started modifying the processor. So starting from the processor, we created in 2013 the first chip based on the pulp concept. So basically, the pulp concept, the key concept behind pulp is basically exploiting a kind of data parallelism in a cluster composed of multiple cores operating in parallels. So basically, one of the key IPs we use in all our projects, in all our chips, is this logarithmic interconnect you see you have between the processor and the core. And basically, in the memory is composed of a multi-banked memory with bank level interleaving, word level interleaving, that allows the cores to share the data in a very efficient way in a cycle, which is kind of similar architecture you have in a GPGPU, but scale down into the IoT kind of applications and with full processors in order to provide a more flexibility. In this first full chip, basically, was a tester-only chip, in the sense that we had no peripherals. It could only connect through the JTAG, load some codes in DL2 memory, and run some tests. And moving forward, we started improving the architecture, increasing the capabilities of the peripherals. For example, here in PAL V2, we integrated some SPI slave and master. We created an iCache interconnect and a shared instruction cache based on the AXI protocol. The previous one was based on a proprietary IP from XT Microelectronics. And this started to improve the architecture. And the architecture was further improved in the third version of the chip, where we integrated, let's say, some key blocks to improve the energy efficiency of data parallel IoT systems. One of these blocks is the DMA, which is necessary to efficiently share data between the different levels of memory hierarchies. One of the other blocks is the hardware synchronizer, which was used to accelerate the typical data parallel tasks, such as synchronization or thread dispatching, which is necessary if you want to parallelize code efficiently in an IoT application. And we continued improving the architectures. So after quite a lot of efforts, let's say, we achieved the first, let's say, big milestone in terms of publication, which is, let's say, the main role of a university from the achievement viewpoints. And we presented basically the idea of this parallel architecture and open source for IoT at the Hot Chips conference, which is a conference which is basically mainly dominated by big companies with some universities presenting. And one of the interesting things I saw at the conference was basically the presence not only of pulp, but the presence of a couple of other open source contributions, one from Berkeley, and one for University of Wisconsin. So basically, I could feel that something was changing, but something was changing also thanks to RISC-V. We heard about this new ISA at that time, and we heard about the first conference around this ISA. And when I went to this conference, let's say, in Monterey, so I really had the feeling that joining, let's say, the effort with RISC-V in order to build basically the same processors we were doing before, but with a different ISA, could, let's say, change the future of the project, because The community, let's say, around this ISA was much bigger and supported by big industries and so on. Or at least at that time there was a lot of traction and attention around this ISA. So basically, we had our processor. It was a brand new processor based on OpenRISC ISA. We also created some extensions and done all the compiler support, and we had to switch everything to RISC-V. But I think that after 10 years, I can say it was a good choice. And at the meantime, also the size of the group increased. We moved from 5-6 people to 20-30 people in order to, let's say, complete the work and create a full platform of components that could be used to create architectures in different domains. So we created different kind of processors. So RISC-V, which is, let's say, Cortex M3 or M4 equivalent, IBEX, which is Cortex M0 equivalent, SNITS, which is a processor specialized for efficient data processing if coupled with FPUs, vector processors, as well as a full set of peripherals, interconnect, and other accelerators. And of course, together with, let's say, all these IPs, we had to create a complete software stack in order to be able to use in an effective way all the systems we made. So this, let's say, is partially true in the sense that at the time being, we have a stable software stack only for the small IoT processors, while not yet for the HPC processor. But this basically led to tape out a kind of first board-ready chip. With board-ready chip, I mean a chip that could be really used in real applications. So similarly to what you would do with an STM32, which seems, let's say, a trivial task, but in the end it's not trivial because you have to put together a lot of things, peripherals, cores, DMA, power control, and a lot of things. And I would say that this was possible just by decoupling the MCU part, which is the part you see on the left, to the acceleration part. So the main difference between this chip and the previous chips were that in the previous chips we had only the cluster managing all the peripherals. Here we added a fabric controller, which was managing the peripherals independently from the rest of the system and the cluster. So this led, let's say, to also to the success of the PULP platform, and we started getting more traction from the industry. I will see some examples later on. And at a certain point, we got in touch with Rico Connor, who started this open hardware group community. I think that you all know about it. And we started pushing these IPs, so some of our IPs, the most stable one, in particular the RISC-V core, the Ariane core, which is the 64-bit core supporting Linux, some of the other IPs, such as the FPU and the AXI4 components, to this open hardware group, was, and the goal of this group is to bring the IPs from the university, so from research IPs, to industrial IPs that can be used in really industrial applications by means of verifying this IP with an industrial process and creating documentation for it and the support for it. So we had also, let's say, several collaborations with different companies around our open source IPs. And we could get both benefits due to this, let's say, collaboration model. So typically, we have some, let's say, most of the IPs, the platform, coming from the pulp repositories. And then we might have some custom IPs, and these custom IPs might be technology-dependent IPs, such as voltage regulators, LDO, or so on, or IPs coming from the company, or IPs coming from a third party. For example, in some projects, we did not have the iCubeC, and we integrated the iCubeC from a third party. And in this process, typically, there are some co-sponsored resources that work on the full platform, the open source platform. And this basically brings benefits both for the company, that in the end has a system that can use for the project, and both for the open source community, because some of the modifications, verification, bug fixes we could find in the APIs went to GitHub again. And I will show later on some examples, let's say, some concrete examples around this. Okay, so now I will start the, let's say, more technical part, where I will present some of the architectures and the chips we developed alone or mostly together with companies. The first IP I present is Vega, which is an IoT heterogeneous SoC, which is somehow similar to what I shown in previous chip in Marcellus. Basically, it has an host domain with a small RISC-V core and an accelerator composed of eight RISC-V processors specialized for digital signal processing. And let's say one of the evolution we implemented in our SoCs is evolutions toward quantized, let's say, computing. And in particular, in this chip, one of the things we integrated is a transprecision floating point unit, which is basically a floating point unit that can deal in a good way with both 32-bit standard floating point, brain float, and also IEEE 16-bit float numbers, and that can exploit parallelism when used reduced precision operations in order to improve performance. On top of that, one of the main, let's say, contribution of the chip was the integration of a 4 megabyte non-volatile MRAM that demonstrated, let's say, once again, the very proficient model of using open source hardware in conjunction with closed source hardware in order to achieve results. And in particular, in this chip, we had all the, let's say, power management components, DC-DC, LDOs, and the wake-up coming from a third party, Dolphin integration. We had some of the technological components, for example, the MRAM, coming from GlobalFoundries, and the tape-out was done in collaboration and led by GreenWaves Technologies using our IP. So if we compare this architecture was published at ISSC in 2021. And if we compare, let's say, the architecture with respect to the previous generation GAP9, it achieved much higher, let's say, floating point performance thanks to the quantized formats. The other, let's say, big contribution of this chip was related to the capability of running a full deep neural network on chip. And this was basically enabled by two things. The first thing is the 4 megabyte of on-chip MRAM that was large enough to store all the weights of a tiny ML deep neural network such as MobileNet V2. And the software stack we realized for this chip that allows basically to vertically map in an optimized way a deep neural network starting from an ONNX description of the network that can be implemented with PyTorch down to the hardware. And so one of the main contributions of, let's say, this chip in terms of scientific success was the first demonstration of a mobile net into an Internet of Things SoC and the demonstration of the advantages with respect to previous generations that were hosting all the weights of chip. A second example of system on chip for heterogeneous computing is Marcellus, which is basically the evolution of Vega. So basically, the main contribution of this system on chip is an accelerator for deep neural networks that can be used, let's say, in conjunction with the RISC-V cores in order to accelerate deep neural network kernels. And basically, the way, I mean, there are many chips in the world with DNN accelerators, but once again, I think that the main contribution of this chip was the very efficient way of implementing the communication between the digital accelerators and the processor. And also here we got, let's say, a significant improvement in terms of performance. So here, this slide basically highlights the models of collaboration of the two different chips described in the previous slides. On the left, we see the transition from Vega, which was, let's say, an MPW tape-out done in conjunction with Green Waves technologies. And basically, on top of the architecture I showed in the previous slides, we added an accelerators which was similar to the one implemented in Marcellus, and this led to the second product of Green Waves technologies, which is called GAP9, which is, I think, one of the best examples of products based on open source hardware, and this is a chip, not an IP. And we have a collaboration also with Dolphin integration. And the Dolphin integration basically was, the model was a little bit different. They took our cluster as an IP block to accelerate different kind of workloads. And basically, they clean up this cluster, and they created a fully supported software stack for this cluster, and they are selling this as an IP block to be integrated in heterogeneous SoC. And for what concerns GAP9, what we can see here, basically we have a table that you can find on the web, and it's a tiny ML benchmarks. So basically you have on the top part of the table here some neural networks which are typically of the tiny ML 10 ML kind of applications. And what you can see here is that most of the architectures here of the chips are based on ARM cores, and the one from GreenWaves, which is based on RISC-V, basically dominates in terms of energy by more than 1.7x the benchmark. And the reason for that, in my view, okay, there are two reasons. So the first reason is the agility of the company, okay, that could design the architecture according to the specification without having to deal with commercial licenses, with architectural licenses from ARM and so on. And the second one is an architectural reason I was trying to explain before, the good cooperations between the custom accelerators and the RISC-V processors. So if you look at this table, there are also other powerful accelerator. For example, here you have a very powerful accelerator, but when you do computing, it's very important to accelerate a lot the main kernel, but if you don't accelerate also the rest, basically the Amdahl law comes back to the door, and it's very difficult to get good results on an overall application. And I think that one of the main advantages of using PULP in computing is related to this. Okay, so far we have seen let's say the low power side of PULP. So we decided to start from low power architectures also for strategic decision. So, and the strategic decision was, first of all, if you want to build a platform, we have to start with something simple. And the second, at that time, basically, there were no competitors. While in the high-end domain, there were GPUs exploiting parallelism and doing very well. They are still doing very well. In the low-power domain, there were no parallel architectures. And we wanted to attack, let's say, that angle. But let's say, with the evolution of PULP, we had a lot of people that were asking us to create more high-performance things or application class kind of architectures. So basically, we started to work on more high-performance kind of architectures, where we can basically join a Linux-capable cluster, which is basically Ariane Core, that now is CVA-6, with a parallel many-core accelerator. And let's say all the building blocks were already there. So the architecture, which is called Hero, is based on a cluster which is very similar to the one I showed before. We had just to create more scalable on-chip interconnects in order to be able to put together multiple clusters or even network on-chips, and a way to have an efficient communication between the host, which is basically support virtualization, and the cluster, which typically works on the physical space. And okay, on top of this, we developed off-chip memory controllers. I will talk a little bit later about this kind of controllers. They are not full-blown LPDDR for obvious reasons. Okay, on top of that, we developed also an heterogeneous software architecture based on OpenMP that was used to offload in an efficient way parallel kernels from the host to the accelerators. Okay, this is everything pretty standard. So you have your OpenMP primitives and you can use them to do the offload. And we are also working on an heterogeneous compilation frameworks. So one of the problems when you deal with heterogeneous architectures is the compilation. Sometimes you have some part of the code which has to be compiled with LLVM, other parts with GCC, and it's a complete mess. So in this project, we are merging all the things together and creating a heterogeneous compilation flow based on LLVM. So the first, let's say, demonstration on silicon of this architecture is Shine, which is a heterogeneous SoC for autonomous secure navigation of autonomous nano drones. And in this architecture, basically, we have an Ariane processor here, a parallel multi-core accelerators, and we support, let's say, some security and isolation features. Since we have, let's say, in this project, some other partners, for example, the group of Sandro Pinto from University of Migno, which is working on the H extensions, hypervisor extensions for Ariane. They are actually pushing these extensions to the Open Hardware Group GitHub. We have some extensions for side channel attacks and a pulp cluster and a memory controller which is based on a digital, fully digital IPs, the HyperRAM from Cypress Semiconductor, now Infineon. And this is an IP we developed in order to have sufficient memory in a system on chip to deal with large applications, such as a small release of Linux, but without having to put on the chip a full-blown DDR controller, which basically require integrating an analog IP, buying the analog IP, or engaging with silicon companies to integrate this on chip. And most of the times, it's not affordable. And sometimes, as I will see, it can be affordable, such in this project called Okami. So basically, Okami is a high-performance project. So while the previous class of processors is application class processor, so basically it's high-end embedded, these processors is meant to be an HPC, so to go in servers, or at least to be a demonstrator of a system that could go in server. And in this project, we engaged with Global Foundries and other partners because they wanted demonstrations of their technology in the domain of HPC. So in this system, we have two chiplets implemented by the Okami system on chip. We have We have an interposer in 65 nanometer technology. So the Okami SoCs are in 12 nanometer technology. The interposer is in 65 nanometer technology. We have two HBM memories. And we have the fan-out PCB, which is basically 52 by 45 millimeter. And this system is basically a scaled-up version of the, a kind of, let's say, scaled-up version of the Hero system I was proposing before. So here we have a CVA6 core, which is basically acting as a controller for a large fabric integrating multiple clusters of processors implemented in a hierarchical way. So this is kind of similar to a GPU. So here you have the CVA6 processor, you have the multiple clusters which are grouped into quadrant, and you have a very large hierarchical AXI4 interconnect that connect all the cluster together. And here on the left, you have the HBM memory controller, which was donated by Synopsys, if not mistaken, Rambus, and a serial link, die-to-die link, which in this project is a digital link because the custom IP was not compatible with the metal stack of the HBM. So we had to create a digital link working in parallel. So inside the cluster, we have a RISC-V-based processor. So one of the, let's say, main differences between IoT and the HPC domain is that, first of all, in the HPC domain, you want to have a floating point, and you want to have a 64-bit floating point, and you want to be very flexible. So basically, what we did in this project is replacing the processors we have typically in the PAL clusters with very tiny processors called SNITs, featuring some extensions, basically providing the capability to run out-of-order workloads in a very efficient way. So basically, the concept here is that you are using very tiny processors for controlling very big FPU. So you have most of the energy of your cluster spent in useful, let's say, useful stuff such as computing. So the chip was taped out a few months ago, and now is being tested since a couple of weeks. So there are some problems with the interposer, but I hope we can fix it soon and get it working. So a few words about the next architectures. The first architecture is Alsaker. The tape out of this is planned for December 2023, and this is basically an improved version of Shane, where we are going to integrate a dual-core cache-coherent cluster of Ariane processors, which will be based on the cache-coherent IP, which was presented by Plan 5 yesterday. And we have a secure subsystem integrated in the SoC through mailboxes, which is based on the OpenTitan IP from LoRISC. And the final big project, so the next big project is going to happen in the pulp project with the tape out of the first chip planned for December is Carfield. The goal of this project is to build the pre-competitive RISC-V autonomous SoC in order to do research on automotive kind of systems and to establish a collaborative research roadmap with both universities in Europe and in the world and the main big companies which are let's say in this market. In this case the silicon will be donated by Intel and let's say this activity is also fully aligned with an initiative from the European Union which is connected with the CHIPS Act, the European CHIPS Act. And okay, basically in this system we will have a dual core cache coherent protocol, dual core cache coherent host with hyper bus based memory controller. We are going to have some specific blocks for safety, critical and real-time tasks, including predictable AXI interconnect. So we are adding some predictable features to the interconnect. We are adding predictable features to the scratchpad memory and we are creating a safety island with triple lockstep cores. We are working on a security island. This is the same as before based on OpenTiton. We are extending the set of peripherals in order to address the automotive domain. We have these two peripherals that at the moment we got from other open source repositories. And we are creating some acceleration block based on vector processors for, let's say, general purpose floating point computations and a more traditional cluster similar to the ones I've seen before for efficient inference of deep neural networks. Okay, so that's it. So this is a picture of the PULP team now. We made a big party in Lugano in June to celebrate the 10 years of the project. And so we are still having a lot of fun.
Yeah.
Thanks a lot.
Thanks, Davide. There's a lot there. I remember when you first came to Cambridge and you presented the Orion core, and we were like blown away.
I think in Cambridge I presented just the modifications to the.
On 1200.
Yeah.
Okay. All right. Yeah. But then you did, and you taped it out at that point.
Yeah. I think Schiavone presented the Orion core at the, I don't know.
The next one.
Yeah. Oh, I think this was that turn then, right? You had the Orion core immediately how you added the RISC-V front end instead of the.
Yeah, maybe.
Yeah, that was the final Open RISC. But anyway, we were just blown away that someone had taped out Open RISC. We were so excited. Silicon proven. All right, question.
Sorry, there's a couple of questions. I'll go backward from your slide. So this is regarding car field, right? So you would need for automotive lockstep-based processor for ISO 26262, right? And this you are based up, you are like, you will depend upon Infineon with the tri-core technology or right? You will develop your own tri-core specification for car field?
Yeah. It's not, we'll not, actually, I mean, also Infineon is moving to RISC-V. So
yeah.
I was at Infineon last week, and yeah. I mean, in the long-term roadmap, they're moving to RISC-V. But in any case, yes, the idea is to develop something on your own. But in this project, we don't want to compete with Infineon or ST. We want to put some effort together in order to create a pre-competitive platform in order to make research on it, out of it.
Okay. This is regarding the micellars that you showed, right? And you said that it used this ML-ISA extensions.
Yes,
right?
Basically this extension, it's an ISA extension. Okay, I'm not go. Basically you have two different kind of extensions. The first is the capability to do SIMD on 4-bit or 2-bit operand. So basically you can do 16 2-bit operations in parallel or 8-bit 8 4-bit operation in parallel per processor. And then you have another extension, which is the MAC and load. And with this extension, you can fetch one data, load it in a register file, and do the multiply and accumulation in pipeline, basically.
Okay, but vector extensions won't have done the same thing? That is RISC-V vector extension if you would have used? Because they tell me this is what they will enable the machine learning as a similar.
Yeah. We have a processor with a vector extension, which is this one. We are working on this, but let's say from our point of view, it was we started this long time ago, and the vector extension of RISC-V were not yet done.
Okay.
So from our point of view, it was more straightforward to starting with this kind of approach, where you have data parallelism at core level and the SIMD at the level of the 32-bit instructions.
Okay, that was just last question. So this one, I just wanted to ask you now, from Vega, when you move to Marcellus, right, the time is like 2 years. So this is how much I just want to understand that, because Pulp is like a very high efficient in the academia group. So this is usually the time that you take to move from one generation to other, because like NVIDIA, every year they bring a new GPU or something, right? But so I just wanted to compare.
I mean, it also depends on the industrial interest we have. I mean, both Vega and Marcellus were industry driven. Now we have a new one with the Meta, and it's coming out this year. So more or less, yes, 1-2 years.
Davide, I have a quick question. Oh, sorry, did you have a question?
I'm just asking for the audience, but
sure.
Julius, go on.
In the early days, there was a lot of focus on the FDSOI process and kind of power savings due to that. I didn't hear many mentions. Is it just assumed that not only is the architecture inherently low power, but you're also doing FDSOI kind of...
I mean, at the beginning, there was a lot of... a focus on FDSOI, because we had this collaboration with ST Microelectronics, and at the architectural level we didn't have so much. So from a scientific viewpoint, let's say the main demonstration of PALV 1, 2, and 3 was about the technology. We were demonstrating the capabilities of body biasing as a way to implement power management in multi-core processors. Yeah, I did not focus on this now, because it was more about architecture.
Yeah. Oh, cool. But later on, it's still like I don't know.
Yeah, because now we have the technology from GlobalFoundries.
Yeah.
So FDSOI is kind of European technology.
Got it. Yeah.
I think this is the reason why.
Do the GAP guys use body biasing in their products?
Yeah, for a process compensation.
Yeah, cool.
Nice. And we used it also in Marcellus.
Cool, okay.
Hey, I have two questions actually. Basically, for security point of view, do you also do logic locking inside the CPU and instructions for that also specified?
Yeah. We have a collaboration with New York University in Abu Dhabi, and they are bringing, we integrated the logic locking inside Shaheen.
And also, do you have any roadmap for the high speed networking chipsets where we had the for CRC unit instructions?
Sorry?
Do you have any roadmap to bring this platform into high-speed networking chipsets?
No, not at the moment.
We have the CRC kind of instructions.
I mean,
which ARM is so far not able to do that.
I mean, at the moment, as accelerators, we have only for cryptography and so on, we have only what is inside OpenTitan.
Yep. But
it took quite a lot of time to massage it and fit inside the system.
I have a question. So you mentioned that you have some countermeasures against timing side channel attacks. And what type of countermeasures? I suppose it's for the cache access, right?
Yes, it is called the temporal lockstep instruction. Basically, it's an instruction that basically clean the state of all the final state, the relevant final state machines in the memory hierarchy and the state of the processor. So that when you switch from...
So flash and context switch kind of thing.
Yeah, yeah. And we proven that when you use this instruction, basically there is no leakage of information.
And another question. So people like in the hardware security domain always say like you have to protect your chip not just from different types of side channels, but also like fault injection and like the reverse engineering, like the logic locking stuff. What do you think about those threats?
And so first of all, let's say we have implemented the security stuff just in the last 2 years. I'm not an expert of security. And second, I think it's very relevant. But from our point of view, this is a little bit out of context because we are digital guys. And if you want to do something against this kind of attacks, you need to do more, or maybe on the analog side, or both analog, digital, and system. We have not engaged yet to address, with partners to address this kind of challenges.
Yeah, because in OpenTitan, I know they were presenting like a lot of hardening of their crypto cores against those types of attacks, but I was wondering if you focus on that for the pipeline.
No, for the time being, we just integrated it as is. I mean, also the TRNG, we implemented the digital one. We don't have analog stuff inside. So it's very basic at the moment. But we plan to improve it in the future. But we need cooperation with experts. We are not experts in this.
Hi. How do you verify those SoCs? How much brain, how much resources this takes? And is it available somewhere?
Okay, I mean, it depends on the size of the project. For example, for Okami, I mean, Florian was leading the Okami project at the beginning, then he left, but I think it was more than 20 or 30 people working on it for a couple of years. It was a huge effort. For other projects like Marcellus or Vega, the team was smaller, 10 people for 1 year. No. So we don't do, let's say, we have some test benches in system Verilog, no UVM to do block level verification. And when we put everything together, we have a set of, software-based regressions. So we have several of tests for the main components of the system. For example, we have our pad frame, and we have all the peripherals connected to the pad frame, and basically verification IP, very basic verification IPs. And we test the connectivity of the IPs. But I mean, from the viewpoint of a university, I mean, even if these IPs are not verified with UVM 100% of coverage, so we were able to run end-to-end applications. This is what I want to say. We don't have the effort to spend a lot of time of PhD students to do verification. The goal is to do the chip and demos.
And you have good connections to the fab and don't regret every spin, right?
Sorry?
And you have good connections to the fabs, so you don't regret making mistakes.
Yeah, you've possibly just answered it from what you're talking about verification, but I was just wondering for your automotive platform, if you'd had any thoughts about whether or not you can explore how you could potentially certify that platform, or if someone will be taking the work there and building a certified part. So I'm thinking specifically in automotive, you're looking at like the ASIL, A, B, C, D. I think everyone wants ASIL D, but sometimes you end up on ASIL B. Is that the scope of the project? Or
No, it's not a part of our project. I mean, in our project, we wanted to deal with computing challenge, develop open source IPs such as predictable solutions for the AX interconnect and so on, but for sure we are not going to deal with the certifications. I mean, then if we engage with a company, okay, and the company gives us the specification for the interconnect and more details about how to achieve certification, we can reach a certain point. And then this has to move to the company, in my opinion, which is kind of the role of Open Hardware Group, or what we have done with other IPs and the Open Hardware Group.
Any other questions? You are ready for beer.
Cool.
Sorry?
Do you respin? If you make a mistake, no.
For example, Vega, okay, was an MPW, and then Green Waves made the product out of it, and they respin it. I mean, if we see that something is wrong with Vega, okay, we did Marcellus. we never did a respin with the same architecture as the previous one. I mean, if you see the evolution of the chips is incremental. So in a certain sense, everything is a respin of PAL P1.
So your entire 10 years are just respins, right? Just, you're adding features with every respin.
Yeah, I mean, we respin and we add the features.
So, one last question. And then we conclude 10 years of respins.
Yes.
Yeah. Sorry, for my...
This is from the historical part now of your slide. So when you move from Open RISC to RISC-V, it was just because it had a wider acceptance at that time, not due to a technical reason, right?
No. There was we fought a lot inside the group. Because
a lot of calls or there's people that might.
Yeah, we are, first of all, we have a lot of opinionated people in the group, so the point of the others was okay. Why ever we should spend I don't know 3 years of a PhD in order to redo the processor and the compiler, which is a lot of engineering work, something like verification probably even worse, My answer was, I was in favor of RISC-V because I attended the conference, and there were a lot of companies, and for me it was clear that something would have happened. And actually, yeah, now we are taking the benefits of this.
I also voted for RISC-V, by the way, none of us asked. Thank you very much. Thanks again.
Thank you.
It was very great.
Do I want to say